Pesticide applications can pose potential hazards for people and non-target organisms. When selecting a pesticide, it is important to consider how people could be exposed to it and the various methods available to reduce that exposure. Likewise, direct and indirect impacts on wildlife and beneficial organisms and the means to reduce these impacts must be adequately considered. Toxicology is the science that deals with poisons and their effect on living organisms. All pesticides are toxic at some level. Some pesticides are more toxic than others and therefore present higher risk to users, non-target organisms, and the environment. Toxicology is based on the premise that a relationship exists between the dose, the amount of pesticide applied, and the response, the toxic reaction, and that there is almost always a dose below at which no response occurs or is measurable. I'm Dr. DeBusk, and in this video, I'm going to discuss health and non-target concerns with pesticide use. Toxicity is the general term used to describe the potential for a chemical to cause harm. Toxicity is commonly measured by the lethal dose, LD, that kills 50% of the animals tested, LD50. LD50 is expressed as milligrams of active ingredient of pesticide per kilogram of body weight of the test animal, milligrams per kilogram. A pesticide with a low LD50, for example, 5 milligrams per kilogram, is very toxic, whereas a pesticide with a high LD50, for example, 1,000 to 2,000 milligrams per kilogram, is less toxic to the tested animal. Toxicity measurements are used to compare the lethal potential of one dose of one pesticide with another. The LD50 does not provide information on long-term toxic effects. While a pesticide with a low LD50 can pose a higher risk to one with a large LD50, it can often be used safely provided precautions are taken to protect non-target organisms. Another measurement of toxicity is the lethal concentration of a pesticide in the air or water that will kill 50% of the test animal population, LC50. The table shows the toxicity and potential for causing injury to people for the three toxicity categories, danger, warning, and caution. Hazard, the inherent ability of a pesticide to produce an adverse effect, is a constant for a particular pesticide product. Risk in toxicology is the probability that a chemical will cause harm. In the case of pesticides, risk is a function of hazard and dose. The degree of risk can depend on the concentration of the pesticide, the way it is handled, and the duration of exposure. Many factors impact risks associated with the use of a pesticide product. Different pesticide formulations can substantially influence the potential for hazard of a given pesticide. Formulation may affect its percentage of active ingredient, propensity to drift, phytotoxicity, or persistence in the environment. It may also affect the pesticide's potential for dermal uptake, inhalation, or ability to pass through the skin, oil versus water. Environmental conditions can increase the potential for injuring living organisms. Heat, light, and precipitation can speed up or slow down the breakdown of toxic residues. Weather conditions, for example, that are favorable to drift or inversion layers, can cause pesticides to move beyond the target site, increasing the risk of exposure or environmental contamination. The closer a person or organism gets to an application or mixing activity, the greater the chance that they will receive an exposure dose that will cause harm. For example, the risk of exposure to the applicator is highest during mixing, loading, and application of the material. The risk of exposure to the field worker from residues on the crop increases if field workers are in the field during or following an application. Many steps can be taken to reduce the potential risk of pesticides to people. For example, closed mixing systems allow for the safe handling of toxic liquid pesticides because applicators do not have to handle open pesticide containers, thereby eliminating accidental contact. The use of water-soluble packaging also reduces the risks of exposure during mixing and loading because direct contact is eliminated. Wearing protective clothing and equipment reduces the risk of exposure when handling pesticides or entering an application site before the expiration of the reentry interval, REI. Personal protective equipment, PPE, includes all or some of the following: waterproof apron, chemical-resistant boots, gloves, head protection, clean coveralls or outer clothing, goggles, face shield, and dust or mist-filtering respirator, or an organic vapor-removing respirator. Personal protective equipment prevents pesticides from contacting the body and eyes and can also protect against inhaling pesticide dust, droplets, and vapors. PPE requirements are listed on the pesticide label. Entering or working in a treated area soon after an application increases the risk of exposure to harmful levels of pesticide residues. Observing the established restricted entry interval is an important requirement to reduce this type of exposure. The pesticide label provides guidelines for re-entry intervals. A pesticide-related illness or injury may have a sudden onset and last for a short duration before the person recovers. This is acute illness. Usually, the exposed person recovers as a result of medical treatment, but with a severe exposure, the person may die. The most common symptoms include headache, rash, or eye irritation. Exposure to some pesticides produces chronic health effects. These are long-lasting and often permanent disorders, such as cancer, permanent nerve damage, sterility, and blindness. One good source of information to assess the potential health hazard from a pesticide is Safety Data Sheet, SDS. Some pesticide labels also have important information on health hazards. All labels have one of three signal words, caution, warning, or danger, that indicate the level of acute toxicity based on animal studies or other hazard posed by the pesticide product. The signal word indicates the degree of risk to the user and is usually measured in terms of oral or dermal toxicity. Along with signal words, labels include precautionary statements about the most common route of entry, usually dermal or oral, and specific actions that must be taken to avoid exposure. Even after a pesticide is applied, the risk of exposure may remain because residues may stay on the treated surface for a period of time. Residues are important and necessary in some types of pest control because they provide continuous exposure to the pest, improving the chances of control. They are undesirable, however, when they expose people and other non-target organisms to unsafe levels of pesticides. Pesticides can remain as residues on or in the plant material and in soil, water, or on surfaces in non-target areas. To protect the public from harmful residues on harvested produce, federal law establishes pesticide residue tolerances for all materials registered for use on agricultural products. These tolerances are based on laboratory and animal testing with a margin of safety to allow for differences in people and to protect children. These tolerances, also known as maximum residue limits, MLRs, are established for each commodity the pesticide is used on. Pre-harvest intervals prohibit application of some pesticides during a specified time before harvesting a commodity. These are established to allow residues to break down before reaching consumers. Pesticides can enter the body through four major routes: dermal, absorption by the skin; ocular, through the eyes; oral, ingestion through the mouth; and inhalation, breathing into the lungs. Dermal exposure is the most frequent type of pesticide exposure by those using pesticides. Certain pesticides injure the skin, while others may pass through the skin and affect internal organs. Absorption into the body starts as soon as the pesticide touches the skin and continues as long as there is contact. Wear the proper PPE and avoid contact with treated surfaces. Ocular exposure is the second most frequent type of pesticide injury. Wearing protective eyewear can protect the eyes. Oral exposure usually occurs accidentally, for example, by drinking out of a container that has had a pesticide stored in it. It also occurs through splashing of spray materials and pesticide dust into the mouth, by eating or drinking contaminated foods or liquids, or by smoking while handling pesticides. Inhalation exposure occurs if dust, mists, or vapors are inhaled during mixing or application. Inhalation or respiratory exposure is particularly hazardous because pesticides are quickly absorbed by the lungs and transported in the bloodstream or to other areas of the body. Many state and federal regulations are in place to protect employees working in urban landscapes, farms, forests, nurseries, and greenhouses from occupational exposure to pesticides. The federal regulation that governs all aspects of agricultural pesticide use is the Federal Insecticide, Fungicide, and Rodenticide Act, FIFRA. The Worker Protector Standard, WPS, is an amendment to FIFRA designed to set standards for basic workplace protection. The WPS is intended to reduce the risk of illness and injury from occupational exposures for agricultural workers and pesticide handlers. Its requirements include protection during applications, restricted entry intervals, personal protective equipment, notification of workers, decontamination supplies, emergency assistance, pesticide safety training, and access to labeling and site-specific information. If the workers speak another language, training and signage must also be in the language of the workers. Safety data sheets, SDSs, are another tool that provides information about the potential hazards from using a particular pesticide. An SDS, prepared by the manufacturer, is available for every labeled pesticide. It describes the chemical characteristics of active and other hazardous ingredients and lists fire and explosion hazards, health hazards, reactivity and incompatibility characteristics, along with the types of protective equipment required for handling. Storage information and emergency spill or leak cleanup procedures are described. LD50 and LC50 ratings are given for various test animals. Emergency telephone numbers for the manufacturer are also listed. Workers who handle pesticides or work in the field where pesticides are applied must be told about the potential hazards in the workplace and must be provided with information on how to avoid these hazards. They must also be trained on what to do in case they are exposed to pesticide sprays or residues. The SDS for each material that they may be exposed to must be available and accessible to workers at their request. Non-target organisms include all plants, vertebrates, invertebrates, and microorganisms in or near a treated area that are not the intended target of a pesticide application. Pesticides can injure non-target organisms directly or indirectly. Direct poisoning harms non-target organisms that encounter pesticides during application or directly afterward by coming into contact with harmful residues. For example, pesticides applied while bees are foraging in the treated area can harm them and other pollinators near the application site. The table on the slide lists examples of pesticides that are highly toxic to bees and those with low or no toxicity. Migrating birds and other vertebrates can be harmed by improper applications of granular pesticides. Drift from an application site can harm nearby wildlife, livestock, pests, and sensitive plants. Residues remaining on crop plants may kill natural enemies, pollinators, birds, or other wildlife immigrating into the site after the application. It may be several years after a problem arises before cause and solution can be identified. For example, dormant sprays of organophosphate parathion were commonly applied in California orchards in the 1980s. Early reports from the Department of Fish and Game suggested that these sprays might have adverse effects on raptors. After several years of research, these suspicions were confirmed, and mortality of hawks was directly related to dormant applications of parathion in 1989. Hawks absorbed the pesticide through their feet when landing on treated trees. These findings led to regulatory changes and changes in pest management practices. Use of reduced rates and alternate materials in the 1990s eliminated the problem. Runoff from pesticide applications into nearby ponds, streams, and lakes can harm aquatic animals and plants. For example, dormant sprays of certain organophosphate or pyrethroid insecticides are typically made to stone fruit orchards during January and February, often the wettest time of the year. When it rains soon after an application, elevated concentrations of organophosphate insecticides have been detected in storm drains, rivers, and other waterways. The concentration of these insecticides in waterways is of particular concern because of the potential toxicity to some aquatic organisms at relatively low concentrations. From 1992 to 1995, the U.S. Geological Survey found that concentrations of diazinon in several rivers exceeded levels that are toxic to aquatic life after winter storms. Pesticide runoff in orchards was reduced in the 2000s by treating later in the year and/or switching to sprays of reduced-risk materials, Bacillus thuringiensis or spinosad, that do not run off into water or pose threats to aquatic invertebrates. Pesticide runoff continues to be a threat to aquatic wildlife, however, especially with the use of pesticides applied to control ants and other pests in urban areas. Applications of persistent pesticides can also lead to secondary poisoning of non-target organisms. This phenomenon, called biomagnification, occurs when certain pesticides gradually build up within the tissues of living organisms after feeding on other organisms, pest or non-target, containing smaller amounts of these pesticides. Animals higher up on the food chain accumulate greater amounts of these pesticides in their tissues as time passes. Although this phenomenon is mostly associated with long-band organochlorine insecticides, recent studies show that DDT, toxaphene, and chlordane continue to accumulate and build up in tissues of clams, fish, and other aquatic organisms relative to values in the 1990s and 1980s. These sediment-bound organochlorine insecticides continue to arrive in rivers through soil erosion. Secondary kill may also occur when carnivores feed on dead or dying rodents that have consumed rodenticide baits. The impact of pesticides on non-target organisms can be reduced by choosing pesticides that are less toxic to non-target organisms, applying at times when non-target organisms are least likely to be harmed, using lower rates when possible, and using spot treatments or other methods to selectively place pesticides. For example, pesticide applications made in early morning, late afternoon, or at night are less harmful to bees because they are not foraging at these times. There are regulatory restrictions for applying certain pesticides while bees are foraging. The pesticide label will have a bee advisory box to inform the user of precautions for bees. Warning statements on labels provide information about problems that could occur if the material drifts onto blooming crops or if bees are visiting the treatment site. Likewise, statements such as "this product is toxic to fish" or "keep out of lakes, streams, rivers" helps you evaluate the potential impact of a material on non-target organisms. Federal and state laws are in place to protect endangered species from extinction. An endangered species is any rare or vulnerable animal or plant species that is endangered of becoming extinct. To ensure that endangered species are protected, the use of certain pesticides in areas where endangered species are known to exist may be highly restricted. Before using a pesticide, read the pesticide label carefully for precautions to protect endangered species and for the location of restricted areas. In conclusion, pesticides are important and necessary pest management tools for agriculture, urban landscapes, forestry, and public health, but they must be handled with appropriate caution to minimize exposure and avoid risks to human health and non-target organisms.